Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Varanjit Thalakaratna. We would like to take this time to introduce Sri Lankans Without Borders by answering some frequently asked questions. Who are Sri Lankans Without Borders? We are a grassroots network of artists, musicians, chefs, students, wine connoisseurs, professionals, mothers, brothers, and much more. We are tied by our Canadian identity and our love for the people of Sri Lanka, regardless of ethnicity, class, sexuality, caste, religion, or any other technicalities. What do Sri Lankans Without Borders want? We are committed to promoting productive intercommunal dialogue within all Canadian communities of Sri Lankan origin. Nelson Mandela put it best when he said, "If you talk to a man in a language he understands, that goes to his head. If you talk to him in his language, that goes to his heart." All members of Sri Lankans Without Borders speak from their hearts, and many of them hold differing viewpoints and speak different languages. But we share a common respect for one another that allows us to listen without judgment, build consensus, and build bridges. What has Sri Lankans Without Borders done? We know that sometimes life gets in the way of helping out with the greater good. But the impact we can have, as well as the fulfillment of personal enrichment we receive, has compelled many to organize and attend Sri Lankans Without Borders events. Sri Lankans Without Borders have concentrated on an event-centric platform to encourage participation and yield constructive outputs. Some of our past events include Roots for Reconciliation, where we got a bunch of our community together to plant trees, Hot Topics, Networking and Mentorship Conference, book reading events, and more. One of our perennial favorites is the Hot Topics event, where attendees learn to cook and enjoy authentic Sri Lankan food while pairing it with favorite wines and discussing an issue of importance to the community. Topics include identity, immigration, human rights, and diaspora dynamics. We invite you to join us in a warm and friendly atmosphere where you will meet bright and caring people who are ready to share their views and continue building a supporting and sustainable community model. I'm going to hand it over to Sudami over here.
So I'll answer the question of why do we want to do this. The issues in Sri Lanka have persisted for well over three decades, and they continue on despite Sri Lanka and its diaspora entering a post-war era. We believe that peace and the freedoms associated with justice, forgiveness, love, and equality can be shared with all people, both in our motherland thousands of kilometers away and here at home in our own backyard. We believe that we share a common culture and history, and through the best of times and the worst of times, it has been a common denominator. We believe that ultimately, without knowing each other, we will never understand one another. Without understanding one another, we may not help one another. Without helping one another, we can never fully prosper. With that, we hope you will continue to come out to our events, and you will come out and continue to get to know us, and let us get to know you. So now I'm going to introduce Craig Scott. Craig is a professor of law at Osgoode Hall Law School in Toronto, and he's also the director of the Nathanson Center on Transnational Human Rights, Crime, and Security, and they have been a generous sponsor of this event. His work spans public international law, conflict of laws, legal theory, and Canadian and comparative constitutionalism. And I'd like to ask Craig to come up to start the discussion.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Sutan. I just wanted to say that the Nathanson Center at on Transnational Human Rights, Crime, and Security, York University, based at Osgoode Hall Law School, we're extremely happy to be co-sponsoring the event. I think it's been put together with a great deal of thoughtfulness, and obviously the entire event has been well thought through. Quite obviously, we here in Toronto and Canada generally need more events of this sort, and dare I say, hopefully the time will arrive when events like this are common and push things forward in Sri Lanka itself. I'd like to also put in a plug for an organization that I've been involved with since the very end of the conflict in spring of 2009, simply to direct you to the website and encourage you to think of it as one of your sources of information around what is happening, what has happened in Sri Lanka. It's the Sri Lanka Campaign for Peace and Justice. You can go to SriLankaCampaign.org. It's an organization that grew up based in London, England. It's chaired by Edward Mortimer, who is the was the former communications director for Kofi Annan for 5 years at the UN. Has a very serious advisory council, including Lakhdar Brahimi, the former Algerian foreign minister, widely credited with having negotiated one of the peace settlements in Lebanon some years ago.
Mr. Wise has accounted his experiences in his recently published book, The Cage, The Fight for Sri Lanka and the Last Days of the Tamil Tigers. And to the very right is Mr. Stanley Samarasinghe, and he is the adjunct professor at the Payson Center. Sorry, I should say Dr. Stanley Samarasinghe. And he's also the chairman and executive director at Global Vision, which is an independent think tank in Kandy, Sri Lanka. Prominent in the fields of economics, international development, and conflict studies. Gordon, do you want to start us off with a couple of minutes of what you'd like to say?
Oh, sure. I've prepared some piece. Thanks very much, everyone, for a start, and thanks to the organizers. It's a real honor to be here, and to be here sitting with people who have a huge depth of experience, much more than me in so many ways, in relation to Sri Lanka. I was invited to quite a few events by different Sri Lankan organizations. This is the only one that I've consented to attend, and I'm very honored to be here. I think it's a unique and powerful experiment that is being undertaken in Canada, so thanks for your patience. And I apologize in advance for anything that I say that offends anyone in the room. I was asked to make a few comments, and I chose to make some remarks on the issue of the peace versus justice dichotomy. So I will just read from these prepared remarks, if you'll forgive me. I'm here to touch on the peace versus justice dichotomy facing Sri Lanka, but I'll also mention how these matters are linked to the world at large. I'm going to briefly consider the peace versus justice dichotomy at a purely local level, then the potential impact of the international criminal legal system on Sri Lanka, and finally the role of the Sri Lankan counterinsurgency model. These are introductory remarks only, and they're not complete, and they're calculated to encourage a response, which I think is the purpose tonight, is to encourage discussion. The argument between peace and justice is, at its extremes, well-known contended space. The argument is whether, during or at the conclusion of a war, justice is a precondition for peace, or at least a parallel condition, or whether peace can exist without justice. The question is particularly pertinent in the cases of civil war. Many current international law practitioners claim that there can be no amnesty for war crimes or crimes against humanity. Perpetrators must be prosecuted regardless of the consequences because, they argue, seeing justice done is a self-evident good that outweighs any potential harm. It's held to be the responsibility of a national judicial system to do so at first instance, failing which the international legal system has become increasingly influential in the pursuit of perpetrators of crimes against humanity. On the other hand, practitioners of international diplomacy argue that this black and white approach often undermines peace in fragile societies attempting resurrection after prolonged conflict. Sri Lanka, I think, is an example of a country that remains socially fragile, even though it is militarily secure, and so we would have to consider whether the pursuit of allegations of wrongdoing would undermine peace in Sri Lanka. My own view is that, contrary to wishful thinking, history shows that it's quite feasible for societies to be reconstructed after the most fearful civil conflicts without the use of any justice mechanism to satisfy the aggrieved. To take Spain as a commonly selected example, the losers get to live with their grief until they die off. Their emotions are held in check by fear. Recently, the justice versus peace argument has been stoked up by the increasing use of indictments during conflict situations, such as that just seen in Libya. But Sri Lanka is quite different. On face value, it's a society that's moved beyond conflict, and I think we can't deny the benefits and the dividends that have come with peace. The war is over, and the victorious and democratically elected government remains in power. Again, we would have to ask whether there is much to be gained in Sri Lanka by pursuing allegations of grave crimes. Recent international legal activism cannot be neatly separated from the political changes that it reflects. Why is the ICC, the International Criminal Court, continuing to gain influence and power? I suggest that it says a great deal about the way that states increasingly choose to conduct politics. What we are seeing is the growth of the rule of law as a measurable and increasingly predictable standard in the conduct of foreign policy and relationships between states. The use of the ICC says more about the use of power than it does about the application of justice. Linked to this, and it is directly linked to it, we heard a lot of talk about the so-called Sri Lankan model of counterinsurgency at the end of the war. I think that many countries have a vested interest in ensuring that this so-called model does not become a normative standard, and that one way they will address this is by ensuring that allegations of grave crimes are dealt with at an international level if domestic mechanisms fail. What has all this to do with a better future for Sri Lanka? I'm going to leave that as an open question for discussion. Thank you.
Amarnath, would you like to offer some opening remarks?
Sure, yeah. Thanks for having me. I've been researching the diaspora for some time now, and it's writing the thesis has been a exhausting and fairly depressing endeavor, all for all the wrong reasons. Not just because it's a thesis and they're meant to be depressing, but more so just because the conflict itself, writing the history of the conflict, is a very frustrating. It's a very frustrating history, right? So. So I just want to say a few things about what we mean when we say used words like diaspora, and then say some very brief remarks about the Canadian Tamil diaspora, and then we'll just open it up to the go on to the panel. So the word diaspora is generally used in the academic literature as kind of an inevitable identity marker simply by the consequence of migration, right? Anybody who leaves their country is automatically part of some kind of diaspora. And then this is how it's been thought of for quite some time, and rightly so, it's been criticized as, failing to take into account some kind of the complexity of the people leaving their country, right? Not everybody has that kind of diasporic consciousness. Not everybody has this attachment to the homeland. So some of the recent academic conversations have been around looking at diaspora as a social construct, right? It's not simply that anybody who leaves the country of birth is automatically part of some kind of diaspora, but rather that they have to make a conscious effort to identify themselves politically, mobilize as part of some political movement, right? So it is through that kind of identification that the word diaspora and or even things like diasporic social movements start to make some kind of sense, right? So this idea that there has to be a level of consciousness. You're not simply part of the Tamil diaspora. Unless you're identify as such, and that is a fundamentally political statement, right? That's a fundamentally political move to make. So I'll get into the specifics later on, probably, but in terms of the Tamil diaspora, at the risk of sounding too simplistic, let me just say that after all of the interviews and after all of the fieldwork, I get the sense that the diaspora, again, at the risk of sounding too simple, is divided in terms of some what you could call the practical diaspora and the idealistic diaspora, right? The practical diaspora argues that we need to deal with the needs of the people on the ground in Sri Lanka. And with the defeat of the LTTE, you need to set aside or defer all of the long-term political political aspirations for a later date. The idealistic diaspora says you cannot actually meet the needs of the Tamils on the ground without a political solution, without some kind of devolution of power, or without even a separate state. So this is where you have the conflict often between organizations in the Tamil diaspora, where one group will say, you're not helping people on the ground. The other will say, well, you can't help people on the ground because the Sri Lankan government is not allowing for long-term political solutions or the addressing of minority grievances and so on. So I think I'll leave it there. I don't know how long I have, but maybe we'll come back. Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Amarnath. Stewart, would you like to offer some opening remarks?
Sure. Thanks to Sri Lankans Without Borders for organizing this and for the good work that they do otherwise. And thank you to all of you for coming out here tonight. The topic is spotlight on Sri Lanka. I wanted to shine a spotlight just on one particular issue, which is close to me, which is press freedoms. In 2008, near the end of the Sri Lankan conflict, I visited the offices of the Udayan newspaper in Jaffna. There were bullet holes in the walls. In a back room, I saw a stack of computers that had all been shot up by gunmen. Udayan staff had been repeatedly attacked, killed. Their presses had been burned. The editor-in-chief, Vidyadharan, was imprisoned for some time after that without charge. And 2 months ago, I read another Udayan editor was beaten and left for dead. In Colombo as well, I found journalists work under extremely harsh conditions, and that was the case during the war, and I think all indications I've seen are that that situation continues. Even relatively mild criticism is called treason. Those who stray from the accepted narrative get branded as terrorist sympathizers. Journalists get arrested, beaten, abducted, assassinated. The missing include even a cartoonist, I understand. The war's over now, but I think that an unhealthy press climate remains in Sri Lanka. It's one of censorship and self-censorship. It's one where I think there's unfortunately a sense that you can attack a journalist and you'll never be held accountable. And so I think as a result, journalists work within a very tight, confined editorial space in Sri Lanka. And the result of all that is it deprives citizens of the kind of free flow of news and information and analysis that is really the oxygen of a democracy. Instead, they get articles like this. I don't know if you saw this from The Observer. It's about this event, and the headline is Weiss to address pro-LTT forum. And I don't think I need to say any more about it. And so I think when we talk about the opportunities and challenges, I think we have to recognize that the role of the press is clearly one of them. Sri Lankans, Reporters Without Borders has consistently ranked Sri Lanka near the bottom on its index of press freedoms. I think most recently 158th out of 178. And I don't want to single out anybody in particular for blame. I think there's a whole range of groups that are responsible for pressuring journalists. And I can tell you from personal experience that the LTT during its time certainly used threats and intimidation to silence reporters that it considered a threat to its cause to try and control the media and manage it. But regardless of who's responsible, it's the state that has responsibility for protecting its citizens, journalists included, and for also ensuring that they can do their work unhindered. Now, I don't think this is a particularly difficult problem to solve. I don't think it's nearly as troublesome as some of the economic and political issues that Sri Lanka faces. All it would take, really, is for, I think, number one, the government to stop scapegoating the press, stop demonizing the press. Second, stop arresting and prosecuting journalists for the things that they write. And third, those responsible for attacking journalists must be held accountable. They must be brought to justice. That's the only way to really end the sense of impunity surrounding attacks on journalists right now. A lively, vibrant press is not something that you should just tolerate in any society. It's something you should welcome, because criticism and investigative reporting, they're not treasonous. They're not unpatriotic. These are things that help a democracy. Reporting that's honest helps a society and a government stay honest. It draws attention to drags on progress like corruption and human rights abuses. It challenges and it brings forward voices and information that that inform public debate and that can help make better decisions. And I think journalists and editorialists in any democracy, they must be given the intellectual room they need to do their work. Thank you, and stop there.
Dr. Sam.
Thank you. First, I want to thank Sri Lankan Without Borders, and particularly Vijay and Viranjit for inviting me and the rest of the group. And it's with not without irony that this organization is called Sri Lankan Without Borders, because the 30-year war was about the fight for borders. And so we are here under the auspices of those who don't believe in borders. I have been asked to speak on the economy and governance. And in a way, especially on the governance issue, all three speakers have already touched on. But I also want to make a connection between the economy and governance. Before the 1980s, particularly before the 70s, Sri Lanka was well known in the economic literature as a country which had a very unusual performance in human development, education, health, and so on. Indicators for far above what you would expect from a relatively poor country with a per capita income at that time of about $200 to $300 per year. Now, in that sense, Sri Lanka was cited as a successful example of how to use limited resources. And then came the war. But there again, my friends used to ask whenever I went to speak in fora like this or my university students, how come that Sri Lanka has not become a Somalia or a Liberia or a Sierra Leone? Because even during the war, Sri Lanka's economic growth rate averaged around 4%, which was actually better than the so-called Hindu growth rate of India before economic liberalization. And that's a remarkable achievement. Partly that is because the war itself fed into the economy. That's a fact. That's what economics would tell you. But it also partly tells you about the strength of the Sri Lankan institutions, which were built over a period of 100 years or more, starting with the British, the civil service, the transportation system, and the economy itself. And also don't forget the fact that the economic liberalization of Jayawardene in 1977, in a way, transferred the primary responsibility for the economy from the state to the private sector. So while the state waged a war, the private sector kept on producing just for sheer survival, because there's nothing called a free lunch in the private sector, from farmers to John Keels, if you like. However, if one looks at the numbers very closely, Sri Lanka probably lost each year on average around 2 percentage points of economic growth, or maybe even a little more because of the war. In other words, in the 1960s and the 70s, we did not realize Sri Lanka's economic potential because of misguided economic policies. From about the early 1980s until the end of the war, by and large, we lost some of the growth potential because of the war. Now, what are the challenges given the fact that we are now talking about a post-war? And I very deliberately avoid the word post-conflict for a good reason. We can discuss it later if you like. Essentially, there is catching up to be done. Number two, there has to be restructuring of the economy. For example, Sri Lanka spent in 2010 $1,800 million on the military. That's about 3.6% of that year's GDP. And it probably doesn't make sense for us to spend so much of money on the military if there is no war and if there is peace. Because who are our enemies today? I mean, do we need 200,000 military? That's a question that we need to find out. And in fact, if you look at the literature, you will see that the after wars of this nature, generally there's a demobilization program. And that has so far not happened. Of course, there is no net recruitment, as far as I know, of any significance. But maybe natural wastage and so on will reduce the military, but there has to be restructuring. And also, there are other issues. For example, Sri Lanka has an okay economy in terms of economic growth rate, partly because of heavy investment in infrastructure in the last couple of years in particular, but also because we have a very peculiar economy. Think about Sri Lanka's foreign exchange earnings. Who earns foreign exchange for Sri Lanka? Mostly the poorer women. A, the plantation women who pick tea. B, the garment workers who sit in garment factories and stitch clothes for the Western markets. And C, the housemaids, around 1.5 million or so in all, who go to the Middle East and elsewhere and earn a pittance, and sometimes at risk to themselves. And of course, large social dislocation in the country. So in other words, Sri Lankan economy leads a massive restructuring program to move from ahead from what we were in the last 22, 30 years. Sri Lanka is a country which failed to become a nation, in a sense, because we still think of being Sinhalese, Tamils, Muslims, Burghers, Christians, Catholics, and so on. How many of us call ourselves Sri Lankans? That's the question. And the day that everybody who comes from Sri Lanka and who lives in Sri Lanka starts calling himself or herself, first and foremost, a Sri Lankan, Sri Lanka would not have built a nation. Thank you.
All right, let's get this discussion going. So, Gordon, if we can start with you. And I think one of the most topical issues is the relationship between the West and Sri Lanka. So if everyone and anyone wants to get involved in this and offer their insight. But is it fair to say that the relationship's gone sour between Sri Lanka and the West? I mean, the United Nations and the diaspora with the Sri Lankan government?
Yeah. Well, I think it's always a mixed picture, but there is a tension there born of the fact, the stumbling block that I pointed to for a better future, which are these allegations about what happened in the final phase of the war. And these aren't going to go away until they are satisfactorily dealt with. You know, you can't deny, as I mentioned before, the dividend that has come with peace. There are so many benefits that have come with the end of the war. The economy's taking off. There's a great deal to look forward to. They're talking, I think, about a vastly increased intake of tourists every year. You speak to ordinary people, many of whom might have been supporters of the LTT at one stage, and they will all talk about the benefits of peace and the relief of returning to peace.
Economic power is moving from the West to a significant extent to Asia. And Sri Lanka is no longer dependent on foreign assistance from Western countries to the extent that we were. Although still, when it comes to our exports, we are still very heavily dependent on the markets in Western countries. Just a few days ago, I spoke to a senior official in one of the donor agencies. And the official told me that when we go to Colombo to talk to government officials, they sometimes keep us waiting and usher in the Chinese first. And that tells you a story. Because the leverage that Western countries have over Sri Lanka has diminished considerably. That's just a fact of life. Except for the fact that if you recontextualize it in terms of geography, Sri Lanka can't move away from the tip of India, whether we like it or not. That's there. In other words, that's a fixture. The Chinese are not exactly our immediate neighbors either. The Chinese are more interested in East Asia. And we do have a concept in international relations called spheres of influence. You see, not in my backyard situation. Just as much as during the Cuban missile crisis, the Americans told the Russians, you're not going to have missiles in Cuba no matter what. The same situation can apply in a crisis situation in the relationship between Sri Lanka and India, vis-a-vis the relationship between Sri Lanka and China. And remember that India and the United States are buddies now. And Mrs. Clinton went to Delhi. From there, very unusual for a Secretary of State of the United States government, went all the way to Chennai to have a chat with Jayalalitha, the Chief Minister of Tamil Nadu. So this tells you that one has to be very aware of the long-term trends of international relations and how they are shaping up in order to understand Sri Lanka's future. Thank you.
What carries with you your experiences in Sri Lanka? What have you not been able to shake, or what do you think the world needs to care about more from your experiences?
Well, two things, I guess. One, that my experience reporting there was that by the final weeks of the war, a lot of the Tamil people that I spoke to had themselves turned against the LTT. And that was because, I think, of the way that the Tigers kind of prevented people from leaving. And I think, probably most importantly, the conscription of very, very young children as the LTT was running short of cadres at the end of the fight. They were bringing in, 12, 11, 13-year-olds, giving them a week of training and sending them out to front lines. I think that angered a lot of families and really turned people against the Tigers.
Because we had a generation of war, it was very bitter for everybody, for the Sinhalese, for the Tamils, for the Muslims. Everybody suffered. We also suffered. And I lived in Sri Lanka for part of the war, and then only I moved to the United States. And we were scared to go out sometimes, just to travel around. Now, had we really said, we are going to have a clean break, and there are issues to be addressed, arising from the causes that led to the war, we probably would have been in a very different situation, instead of simply being in a mode of denial. And I think that's the problem that the country is facing now. Whether you can reverse it now, I do not know. Perhaps it's not too late even today. If one were to sort of confront the issues and say, here are the issues, we have to confess. After all, one of the key spokesmen for the Sri Lanka government just 3 weeks ago said, yes, we are not denying that there were no civilian casualties. As opposed to the original story, there were no civilian casualties. That itself is a reversal of a stand that was taken 3 years ago. So probably there is still time for meaningful dialogue.
Gordon, how much of a role has denial played that you've seen? And then how do you find resolution for that?
Well, denial has played a consistent role since the end of the war. But I think one of the points of my writing the book was to say that, in a very crude way, that denial has long been a feature of political and social life in Sri Lanka. I think it's shocking for a visitor to Sri Lanka to first realize that the last war was only a reflection of previous large-scale episodes of violence in which tens of thousands of Sinhalese were killed. So I'm not sure that Sri Lanka ever came to grips with the atrocities of the JVP uprisings. And I think that those, in a sense, predicted the way that this war would be dealt with as well. I find it remarkable and inexplicable to contemplate the consistency with which the current government has held to a really extreme position that ultimately is insulting for people who are standing from the outside and want real answers. To simply say for years and years, no, there were no civilian casualties, we didn't do it. If there were any civilian casualties, it was all the LTT. So by holding to that position, I think denial has been destructive ultimately. Accountability as one of the fundamental building blocks in the post-war situation. The other one was political reconciliation. And there's just been no sign of it. So Sri Lanka's friends are standing back a bit aghast and saying, well, you know, you're a member nation, you're a brother nation, we expect that you will abide by the same sorts of standards that we try to hold ourselves up to in other countries.
Is it, and I'm just going to ask this across the table, is it a question of putting an end to the past, letting go of that, and starting off fresh? Is it clearing the government and trying to get youth involved and having that sort of accountability, and is that attainable? That's the extreme that I'm hearing
here. I think the denial question is interesting because I see denial working almost more than simply in the post-war, so in the accountability discussion. It's almost a denial. The first thing that President Rajapaksa said following the defeat was, there are no more minorities now, right? And I think that's a key statement because it shows that either willfully or willfully ignorantly, he did not understand or is refusing to acknowledge that he understands the underlying causes of the conflict itself. And another event that kind of an indicator of this is the rehabilitation process of the ex-LTT cadres, right? So recently, I think a couple months ago, you had this mass marriages of ex-LTT cadres, and then you had, you know, on-the-job training for ex-female cadres and so on. And I'm not saying that's a bad thing, but I think it signals the ways in which the government is framing the conflict, right? It signals that they are actually starting to believe in the webs that they spin in terms of understanding the cause of the conflict as a war on terror, and therefore to reframe the post-war conflict as, you know, if according to them, it seems the entire conflict was because there were lonely men with no jobs, and therefore there's some kind of conflict that arises. Therefore, you give them a wife and a job, and all of a sudden, all of their grievances disappear, right? So there is no understanding of the long-term political grievances of the Sri Lankan community, of the Tamil community in Sri Lanka. So I think that's a larger, longer-term denial of the conflict that I don't really see a change in the post-conflict situation. So,
Stewart, while you were in Sri Lanka, what sort of people did you meet, the ones who did speak out? What were they saying would be possible solutions? I mean, accountability is one.
It's a hard question to answer because I was there during the very intense sort of fighting times, and then, you know, there wasn't a lot of discussion about that. I was just sort of dealing with the day-to-day issues. But I just wanted to follow up on something that you mentioned about jobs and marriages and all that, and I'm not sure if that's maybe a misinterpretation of those types of rehabilitation programs. I'm not sure anybody's saying that giving somebody a wife and a job is a solution to underlying issues, but I think it's certainly at the end of any conflict, it's very wise to keep, you know, to have people that were fighting return to normalcy and keep them busy and working as quickly as possible to avoid the possibility that you know, they might become frustrated and bored and take up fighting again. So I disagree a little bit.
Don't you think that's a misunderstanding of the radicalization process, though? It's because most studies on radicalization say, you know, it has nothing to do with the causes of radicalization have very little to do with loneliness or boredom or financial insecurity. Most terrorists aren't poor, right? So isn't it a misunderstanding of what led people to join the LTT in the first place? And what I was suggesting is, I think it's a symbol of the misunderstanding that they believe that afterwards you can kind of retroactively heal the process through marriages and jobs, right? I it's probably a stretch because I don't know that that's what they intend, but I'm guessing that that's what they hope to accomplish, right?
The question of Sri Lanka kind of, you know, dividing into two countries probably doesn't arise as long as India is around, because India doesn't want a mini Tamil Nadu in Sri Lanka, because the implications for India in the long term are quite serious. But having, that's only a preface to my remark. My remark really arising from the comments that were made earlier, one should also focus on the Sri Lankan political culture that has evolved in the last 20 to 30 years. In the 1960s, we never heard of opposition candidates being beaten up, opposition supporters' houses being burned, and so on. That was up to the 1965 election. I was very politically aware as a young person living in Sri Lanka about how Sri Lankan elections were conducted. But today it's very, very different. In the 1950s and the 60s, those of you who are gray-haired like me will recall that soon after the elections are announced, flags go up all over the country. Green flags, red flags, blue flags, and so on. People openly express their political views, like in Canada or in the United States. Now today you go and try to conduct an opinion poll, you are not going to get any correct answers, because people are scared. Because politics has become so divisive in the country that it's not the kind of democratic politics that we in the United States or you in Canada experience that finds in Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka has a very peculiar model of a democracy where elections are very regular. On the October 8th, we are going to have elections. On July 23rd, also we had elections. In February, also we had elections. But that means very little in terms of a democracy in the functional sense, as we understand liberal democracy. So now that raises a question about the role of the opposition. In July, I went to listen to somebody who is aspiring to be a leader, the next leader of the country, Premadasa's son, young Sajit Premadasa. And I listened to him very carefully to find out what he has to say, because he's challenging the current leader of the opposition of the major southern political party, the United National Party, and wants to be the leader. And I must say that I was very disappointed with what he had to say. In the way, in fact, it was kind of a watered-down version of his father's 1980s vision for Sri Lanka. 1980s vision for Sri Lanka is no longer applicable to 2011 Sri Lanka. That's a fact, because the world has changed. In 1980s, we didn't have cell phones. In the 1980s, the LTT dreamed of having a separate state in Sri Lanka. In the 1980s, China was, no one discussed China in the Financial Times. But today it's very, very different. So Sri Lankans have to move forward politically as well in a new global context. And that's simply not happening. We are actually fighting even today. We are having the debates of the 20th century when we are now in the 21st century. That's just a fact of life.
Can you then, and how then, do you go back to a time when you could openly show your politics? You can openly express your opinions and views. Is that possible in Sri Lanka, and how do you achieve that? I guess it's assuring public safety, first and foremost. How do you do that? Where do you begin?
It's a good question. I think it's a question of you know, it's almost purely theoretical.
Do you think it's attainable?
Look, I mean, I remain optimistic about every country. I mean, you know, you can't go to Sri Lanka and not be dazzled by the talent. So quite what the key is to Sri Lanka's success, I think, is a mysterious thing. It's a question of process and chaos. I certainly have seen in my lifetime countries that were relegated to basket case status emerging from that status into successful nationhood.
South Africa is a good example.
South Africa, for example. Yeah, although South Africa is challenged, but you know, I think a lot of Latin American countries, for example. So often countries go through terrible wars, and they emerge and they build very successful societies. I think Sri Lanka has very obvious challenges. I don't think there's any secret. I think, in fact, everyone here is in agreement about them. There needs to be better government at all levels. There needs to be less corruption. There needs to be an untrammeled police force. There needs to be a judiciary that functions properly. There needs to be a media that is allowed to be critical without living in fear. But Sri Lanka has bred a culture of violence, as Sam was indicating, that is now close to four decades old.
So it's going to take a generation or so for that attitude to change. And it probably will change. In a way, we are witnessing today, although not in Sri Lanka, but in Canada, we are witnessing that change in this forum today. The young people who have got together to talk to each other is a very significant step. And also remember, governments in any country are only one part of the larger society. There are lots of other layers of society. Now, 3 weeks ago on Sunday, on the 22nd of August, I went to Trincomalee together with a bunch of my friends from Kandy to have a day with Sinhalese and Tamil orphans, 100 of them. And these were little boys and girls, tsunami victims or war victims. And we had a jolly good time. You know, we took a band from Kandy, then we took about 500,000 rupees worth of things for these children, and water pumps, musical instruments, clothes, and so on. Now, this is operating at a sub-government level, if you like, at the society level. And my friends from Kandy were Tamils, Muslims, and Sinhalese. And we went and we interacted with them. And these are very, very tiny things. I agree. I mean, these are not going to make suddenly Sri Lanka change for the better. But these things cumulatively will begin to have an impact. So in that sense, and also remember that today the information flows are very, very different to what they were 20, 30, 40 years ago. Today, you see, I mean, I don't use the Twitter, but I'm sure young people use Twitter. Young people have social networks. And that kind of information and education gets through.